I am so excited about tonight. I have a little surprise for you tonight. This week in our homework, we are going to get into the process and what God does in the hearts of the people and what he does in and through them in order to begin constructing the tabernacle. And I love seeing this homework that we're going to dive into because we just see God miraculously bring his people together. And I don't know if you remember in our lesson last week, but we talked about God's names and we talked about God being our banner, which meant the rallying signal or the miracle. And what we see in the construction of this tabernacle is the people begin to rally around together over this project, and there just seems to be this excitement and almost this sense of revival that spreads throughout the people as they begin to construct this place where God is going to dwell. But obviously, we could do a whole separate study on the tabernacle because there's so much rich meaning in all of the different elements of and we don't have time to get into all of that in this study because we're really just focused on Moses and his relationship with God and God's relationship with his people and our relationship with each other. So we're really focusing on the people in this study, but there's so much beauty in the elements of the tabernacle. So a friend of mine who is another Bible teacher, she teaches out in Philadelphia. She has a ministry called Gospel Spice Life. She is currently teaching a whole study on the tabernacle with her women out there. And so I asked her to record a very short teaching for us, 10 things that the tabernacle teaches us about Christ. And I gotta give you a little backstory on my friend Stephanie. You're gonna immediately notice her accent. So Stephanie is French. She was not born and raised in America. She's French, and you'll pick that up right away. And she became a believer in Jesus as an adult, much later in life. She didn't grow up in church, and so she has this infectious love and passion for the word, which you're going to pick up on immediately. She and her husband have been missionaries and church planters. They've planted churches throughout the Middle East in predominantly Muslim countries. So she has just a very different perspective on things a lot of times than I do as an American girl who, you know, got saved as a young teen. So I love talking to Stephanie. I love her heart for the Lord. She remembers a big part of life without Jesus. So life with Jesus holds a richness for her that sometimes I think when we haven't had a big chunk of our life without Jesus, we can miss. So I think you're going to really enjoy this tonight. I was very moved by her description of the tabernacle and all of the symbolism of it. But if you like this tonight, I want to let you know that this study is completely free on her website, and you do it at your own pace. So when we wrap up here, if you want something to kind of keep you going through the Advent season, and you want to just kind of get back into the tabernacle, refresh your memory on some of that with all of this just right in the forefront of your heart and mind, you can go right on Stephanie's website and catch her teaching videos, download her lessons, the whole thing. So her name is Stephanie Roussel, and her website is Gospel Spice Life. And we're going to get that video going on the tabernacle. Bonjour. So enjoy.
I am so excited to come alongside you today as we experience the tabernacle together. Now, you and I are going to slip on our wilderness desert sandals as we get ready to make our way into the presence of God today. We're going to trek our way towards the tent. It is pitched in the center of a 2 million-strong campsite. And so as we make our way there, as we're holding arms together, let me remind you of how we got here. What a journey we have been on. Just 14 months ago, we left Egypt laden with unexpected riches and most of all with our newfound God-given freedom. Do you remember? We saw God completely crush the selfish, cruel deities of the noble, haughty Egyptian people. We crossed the Red Sea, we tasted the manna, we saw the fire, we heard the thunder from Mount Sinai. We followed the pillar of cloud and fire. Our shoes have not worn off, our clothing has not faded. We can't deny the obvious. God has been taking good and tender care of us. It's gone off without a glitch. Well, except maybe for this one time when that golden calf jumped out of the fire when we just threw our earrings in. Who would have known this was going to happen? Can I be honest for just a moment? It's been hard to learn to rely on God. We can't see him or touch him or hear him. We know without a doubt that he is the one true God. But those Egyptian gods, they were so much easier to understand. They were so much more like us, fickle, selfish, insecure. And that's one lesson we've learned in the wilderness, isn't it? Much as we hate to admit it, we are a stiff-necked, insecure people. And our God is not like us. That is something we are learning to appreciate about him. In his goodness, he has given us the unthinkable, a place to meet with him. We call it the tabernacle. It means dwelling place. It is the place where God has decided to dwell among us. You see, those Egyptian gods, they live in temples and they have to be appeased by sacrifices. Our God lives among us in a tent, just like we do. And he is teaching us how we're supposed to approach him. He's not playing hide and seek like those Egyptian gods. He's telling us exactly where and how to meet him. Who has ever heard of such a kind and gracious God? He's teaching us the most baffling experience. He wants us to trust him. No one has ever heard of trusting any of those many gods. Fear them? Yeah. Appease them? For sure. They only seek their own interest and they will suck the life out of you to appease their own lusts. Those Egyptian gods have names. And our 21st century Western gods have names too. Money, fame, comfort, success, to name just a few. And they too come short of satisfying our deepest longings. And so here in this wilderness of a desert, we are learning to trust the one real God. The problem with trust is that it requires unpleasant circumstances. No one needs to trust God when all is well. But here and now, when we depend on him for our every meal, or every drink, our very survival against the beasts and the barbarians of the desert, now, here, we need to learn to trust. God teaching us to trust by inviting us in his presence, in the tabernacle where he dwells. We focused this past year on building the tabernacle that God gave Moses on the mountain, and what a year it has been. You will find the whole story in Exodus 25 to 40, so you don't need me to remind you. God gave Moses such specific blueprints. It was both very easy and very difficult to build. It's kind of like a large IKEA construction guide. You need to follow every step, and then it's going to go well. But miss a step, or reverse the order, and you're in for a massive headache. God gave many craftsmen a wide array of talents to accomplish the task before them. He said he was going to give them his very spirit to help them build the tabernacle exactly as he wanted it. Who has ever heard of God letting his spirit dwell inside his people? What a privilege. Such profound stewardship is required for such set-apart people. The Hebrew word for set-apart is the same as holy. When God places his spirit within you, you are set apart. Only a handful of people have ever experienced such an honor. Among us in the Old Testament, the Israelites in the wilderness. We all contributed gifts to the tabernacle. It required a lot of gold and silver and fine linen and leather and wood. We had so carelessly thrown our gold into the fire, but we gave to the tabernacle construction with much care, aware of the privilege that we respectfully honored. Who ever heard of a God who would dwell among his people, asking them to build him his temple with their contributions? What an unspeakable honor to place our gifts and our talents in his service. And I know you can relate. After just 1 year, the tabernacle is consecrated. You remember, you and I were there when the fire came down from heaven to light the altar and the sacrifices. We saw the cloud of glory move into the tabernacle tent, hovering above the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat, hidden deep within the tabernacle. That's where we're going today. And here we are now. I can see it. The white linen walls of the outer court are in sight. That reminds us that this is a portable structure. God moves with us. And it's also a temporary structure. It will become a glorious temple under King Solomon, just about 500 years into the future, if you are right now with Moses. You and I don't know it yet because we are just Israelites in the wilderness. But here is what's coming. God will dwell in the temple just like he does in the tabernacle. And that temple will be much more glorious. And yet Ezekiel teaches us that God's glory will leave the temple just before 586 BC, 400 years or so after Solomon will have completed it. And that's how King Nebuchadnezzar and his cronies were able to invade Jerusalem and take us all into captivity. And when we come back 70 years later, we will attempt to rebuild the temple under Zerubbabel, Ezra, and Nehemiah, but God's glory will never return to it. God's glory is absent until one glorious night, described in Luke 2, verse 9. The angel of the Lord appeared to the shepherds in the fields, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. The glory has returned when baby Jesus is born, and it will never again leave planet Earth. John 1:14, Jesus walked among us full of grace and truth, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only. Jesus left us on ascension, but he gave us the gift above all gifts, the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. He made temples of flesh out of us, the believers. That is the New Testament glory. But I'm going ahead of myself. Let's go back to the white linen outer courts of our initial tabernacle. You and I are going to make our way around the fine linen walls, dodging the campfires and the tents of the Levites who are camped right outside the walls. You see, this outer wall is quite small. It measures 75 feet by 150 feet, which is exactly the size of an Olympic swimming pool. See? Quite small. And so we swiftly can make our way to the entrance, passing the tribe of Judah in front of the east-facing entrance of God's meeting place. Let me tell you about the tribe of Judah, this tribe that is favored among all. You see, our Messiah will come from the tribe of Judah. So it's only fitting that they should camp by the gate of the tabernacle where he is coming from. The entrance to the tabernacle is facing east, just like the entrance to the Garden of Eden, the very first place where God met with man. But now the entrance to Eden is closed off with angels guarding the way with fiery swords. The entrance to the tabernacle has a curtain of scarlet and blue and purple, symbolizing blood and God and royalty. But that door does not have the fiery cherubim guarding the way. You see, anyone can enter using the only entrance facing east. There is one way to the presence of God, and that is through that one gate, that one way. There's only one way to enter God's presence, one narrow way. It is available to anyone who wishes, but under God's terms. He is God, and we are not. Now, I hope you didn't forget the animal that you are planning to sacrifice, because that is why we are here, remember? Once we walk in, we are cut off from the rest of the camp. The white walls of the outer court surround us. They're 7.5 feet tall. The priests officiating all around us are dressed in the same white linen. They have a sash of scarlet and purple and blue that matches the open curtain gate that you just walked through, and another in front of you. Your eyes are drawn to the imposing structure before you, our destination, the bronze altar. At 4.5 feet high, it is roughly at eye level for us. It's 7.5 feet aside. It's a square. Basically, it's a gigantic fire pit with a grate inside to roast animals whole. It has four horns on its four corners to tie the ropes to keep the animals down as they are being sacrificed. You see, you and I can relate, because that is the problem with a living sacrifice. It tends to crawl off the altar. How many times have I had to surrender at the feet of the cross again because I had taken the living sacrifice of my life back into my own hands, and I had to re-sacrifice to my God on the cross where he takes it. The bronze altar points to the cross of our Messiah. He voluntarily tied himself down when he didn't have to. Sin was not tying him down like it ties us down. Like the innocent animals, he carried our iniquities. He didn't deserve to die. The animals are not asked their opinion, which is partly why their blood can only cover sin, not erase it. It takes a willing sacrifice. Death is necessary to erase sin, because death is simply the opposite of life, and sin is the opposite of God. And so the only way for the living spirit of God to dwell inside sinful humans is for them to die to sin so they may be raised to eternal life. And that is why our Messiah has come to do this for us, pinning himself on the bronze altar so that the smoke of his sacrifice might raise to heaven and reach God, appeasing his wrath. You see, when the animal dies, the smoke of sin meets the wrath of God to appease it. The smoke and the wrath are the same thing, and they mingle upwards towards heaven, towards Christ. So Christ came down from heaven to meet the wrath of God on the smoke of the altar of sacrifice, the cross. Christ came down to face that wrath of God on the bronze altar on our behalf. Now, through that sacrifice, you have met the wrath of God, and it has not destroyed you, because you hide behind the one who met it for you. The bronze altar is our salvation experience when we meet Christ as our Savior. The bronze altar points to the cross of Christ. There's no wrath left for you as you proceed deeper into the tabernacle complex now. From now on, you will meet water and light and bread and incense, but no more wrath anywhere. From this point forward, the wrath was met at the cross, so that grace is the fullness of the experience of God in Christ, and that is what awaits us. So let's proceed past the bronze altar towards the next element, the wash basin. Oh, but wait. Oh, only members of the priesthood are allowed to experience deeper fellowship with God. Levites are the only tribe allowed past the bronze altar. This is an exclusive experience for the select chosen few. Do you qualify? Do I qualify? Are you a member of the priesthood? 1 Peter 2:9 says that in Christ we are the royal priesthood, the holy nation. So if you are a follower of Christ, having embraced his bronze altar sacrifice on the cross on your behalf, then you are a member of the priesthood, and you are beckoned to experience the wash basin. Made of bronze, from the mirrors of the women who officiate at the entrance to the tabernacle, it reflects your face as you approach. You see, self-knowledge is necessary for God knowledge. Just like we thought those Egyptian gods resembled us so much, we realize that Yahweh is so very much not like us. And that is becoming increasingly a source of relief and joy, isn't it? God gave precise instructions and dimensions to build every piece of the tabernacle, down to the size of the nails, to ground the posts into the ground. But he didn't give the size of the wash basin, because there will always be a limitless supply of water to cleanse you, more than you ever need. Jesus is the fountain of life. We are called to wash our feet and our hands in the wash basin, not the whole body. Exodus 29 explains that the washing, the complete washing of the body, takes place once when the priest is called into the priesthood. They are washed thoroughly once, just like we are at salvation. But whenever the priests need washing of the hands and the feet, that is every time they enter in their daily service for God. We have been entirely washed at salvation, and now we are clean. We only need the occasional daily spot cleaning of our hands and our feet. Just as Peter, when Jesus came to wash his feet. The wash basin symbolizes the Christian walk, starting with that public declaration at baptism. And it follows by daily repentance and growing surrender in increasing awareness of our sinful selves and, more importantly, of our gracious God. Once our hands and our feet are clean, we can enter the tabernacle proper. The curtain that we reverently draw back repeats that same pattern of scarlet and blue and purple with no guarding cherubim. Access is limited, but not restricted. And when you enter, oh, when you enter, darkness envelops you as you adjust to the one and only source of light, the golden lampstand to your left. Its soft light casts hues of gold all around you. And that's an easy task, since the walls are literally gold-plated. The ceiling, high above your head at 15 feet, glimmers with the gold of the cherubim embroidered in the trifold colors of the ceiling. They remind you of heaven above you. In humble worship, you kneel, only to feel the rough gravel of the dirt beneath your feet. Yes, the floor is dirt. This is the only element in the tabernacle that is not built. We are dust, and as dustlings, our very presence is intimated in the dust floor of this holy place. From dust to heaven, from floor to ceiling, the story of God with us, the contrast of our humanity to his deity, is embodied in Christ, fully God and fully man. The holy place echoes his identity in intricate detail, as we're going to see. The golden lampstand to your left is made of solid, hammered gold. It speaks of his deity and of his bruising for us. An oil lamp, not candles, points us to the olive press of Gethsemane and the anointing oil of the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The seven branches speak of the sevenfold Spirit of the Lord. That's in Isaiah 11, verses 1 and 2. And seven is also the fullness of the perfection of Christ in Revelation. He is the light of the world. His Spirit gives us light and understanding as we approach every aspect of our relationship with God. And in the same way, the lampstand brings light to help us see the other elements in the room. Across the lampstand to your right stands the table of presence, made of gold and wood, deity and humanity dwelling together again. It holds 12 loaves of bread and a pitcher of wine offering. The Lord's Supper is right here, when we remember what Christ has done for us by his body and his blood, the bread and the wine, and this ushers us into the presence of God. The loaves are a gift from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. It's a sacrifice of praise to acknowledge that we draw everything we need from God. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, literally the village of the house of bread, Bethlehem, the village of the house of bread. He broke the bread of his body so we could have fellowship with the Father. He's our manna in the desert. He is the bread of life, and no one can enter the presence of God except through the sacrifice of the bread and the wine. The altar of incense beckons us on the far side of the room, and it is tucked away against the famous veil separating us from the Holy of Holies, that innermost room of the tabernacle complex. The altar of incense, that is the most important piece of the tabernacle besides the Ark of the Covenant. It echoes the first piece that we encountered outside, remember? The bronze altar. It takes its coals to light the incense daily from the bronze altar, from the fire of God that lit the bronze altar. That same fire lights the same coals that are used to burn the incense today. The fire from the Lord at the cross fuels the incense of our prayers to Him. This is the place of intimacy. This is the place of encounter, of silent reverence amongst the spices, the gospel spices of frankincense and myrrh. Prayer at the altar of incense is a posture of privilege and reverence. And so after a moment of silent devotion, you lift your eyes to the glorious curtain now before you. It was torn when Christ exhaled his last breath, the last time that his lips worshipped the name of his Father. And so you hold your breath for a second. This veil separates you from the fullness of the presence of God, the weight of the glory that would literally crush you, crush your body under too much weight of glory. Moses was denied access because it was too dangerous. And here, only the great high priest is allowed to enter once a year under drastic measures to offer a very particular sacrifice. Christ. Christ, my friends, is our great high priest, and he has opened the way through his body that we may enter the Holy of Holies with utmost reverence and awe. The cherubim have guarded the way with a fiery sword ever since the Garden of Eden was marred by our sin. But Christ took away the fiery wrath, and the angels step aside for those who enter in his name. And that is why we can enter. So you gently lift the veil, knowing more deeply than ever that you are kept from instant incineration under the holy lightning of his glory because his hands took that blow on your behalf. The darkness would be total were it not for the gentle glimmer that you can't quite pinpoint right there above the angel's wing atop the golden Ark of the Covenant standing before you. You are inside the throne room of God Himself. So instinctively you kneel. In worshipful awe, you take in the gold chest and the mercy seat on top, where the two angels stretch their wings towards one another in a posture of humble adoration. The Ark of the Covenant is the chest, the gold-plated chest beneath the angels. Inside are the Ten Commandments, and during some portions of history, a pot of manna and Aaron's bud that blossomed to confirm his calling as a leader. Now, I want you to camp for a second on the Hebrew word for this particular ark, used only in this context, not Noah's Ark, not any other kind of ark. This Ark of the Covenant, the Hebrew word for it is the word coffin. Yes, this is the coffin of the covenant. The law of Moses, the leadership of Aaron, the manna of the people are all buried inside the coffin that makes access to God possible. The tomb is the dwelling place of the glory. The mercy seat, which sits above this coffin, is where the glory of God actually dwells. It is his throne. Well, more accurately, it is the footstool of his throne. When God looks down from his throne, he does not see the law of Moses inside the ark. He does not see how miserably we have failed to uphold it. You see, The high priest comes in once a year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, to sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice from the bronze altar onto the ark. God does not see the law. He sees the blood that came from the bronze altar. He sees the blood that came from the cross on top of the law of Moses. And that is why you and I can enter. When God looks down from his throne, he sees the mercy seat and the angels in humble adoration, one at the foot of the coffin, the other at the head. Remember the two angels who guarded Jesus' body in the tomb? I will leave you here to commune with your God from the overflow of your heart. Behold, my friend, the glory of the one who crossed the universe to come dwell within you. His name is Christ, and you belong to him. Stay in the Holy of Holies, where you are beckoned to dwell.
Is that not amazing that literally every single aspect of that tabernacle points us to Jesus? And don't you love it? Like going all the way back before they even got rolling on this whole thing, what did God tell Moses? And I am going to give you favor in the sight of the people, and you shall plunder the Egyptians. Remember that? And Moses was probably like, okay, well, how about we just like figure out how to get out of here first? Like, who cares about the plunder? But God had a plan all along. I love it when John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Talking about Jesus. God's plan, he says what in Isaiah? I know the end from the beginning, and nothing can stop my plan. And we see this in this tabernacle. God, from the very outset, is pointing his people toward his son.